I don't want to start with this, but I think I have to. I'm the guy who didn't marry. Educated, well-intentioned, and good girl in our town. I wonder where I'd be today if she had loved me too. Probably be driving kids to school. I guess I went on to Beverly Brown. All of my good times, all my running around. One of these days I might be in your town. I guess I owe it all to Papa the Bell. Seen the lights of cities and I've been inside the door. Sailed to foreign countries and war upon their shore. The guy she married was the best part of my life. She dug him cuz he drove a pickup truck. And I guess I owe it all to Papa the Brown. All of my good times, all my running around. One of these days I might be in your town. Yes, I owe it all to Papa the Brown. I don't have to tell you just how beautiful she was. Everything it takes to get a guy like me in love. Lord, I hope she's happy, cause she sure deserves to be. Especially for what she did for me. And I guess I owe it all to Papa the Brown. All of my good times, all my running around. One of these days I might be in your town. And I guess I owe it all to Papa the Brown. Yes, I owe it all to Papa the Brown. Play this quite often. I guess I don't have to figure out why. Probably some kind of affection for the tune. Look. here I am trying to figure out why I'm doing this. And it's, you know, I don't need to know that. Nobody needs to know. And it's interfering, as we can tell, with what I am doing. What a professional. Every night, at some point in the set, in this case right away, I'm reminded of my friend. I mentioned it last night, my first paying job, which was at Basson's Lounge in Washington, D.C. And they paid you in beer, free beer. I finished my set, I got off, ordered a pitcher of beer, and they charged me for it.
Thank you.
Al Gaber, who was anxious to get out of where he was to some place he'd never been. And he got what he wished for. I hope that never happens to any of you. Because I feel kindly disposed toward you. Wish I had a tiny island floating in the sea. Palm trees sway, don't get in the way. It's a tropical ease. And everywhere that I keep my silence, no sound returns to me. Just endless waves at the end of our days, the sign of the sea. Oh, yesterday's gone. I don't know where I come from. Wonder where I'm going. The very last time that you saw me off, I thought it was understood that I'd be gone for a very long time. I might be gone for good. And all that time, I thought you would never fall. I dawned across my mind the time that you lost it all. And yesterday's gone. I don't know where I come from. Wonder where I'm going. Sometimes I feel like a tiny island floating in the sea. And palm trees sway, don't get in the way. It's a tropical ease. And everywhere I keep my silence, no sound returns to me. Endless waves and the love that you get washing over me. Well, yesterday's gone. I don't know where I come from. Don't know where I'm going. Where I'm going. shed small faces unbound. In places, small faces unbound. Got me a car, you know, by this time, I think I was a senior in high school. you know, 40, 42, 43 years old. And I mean, really. And actually, if I really, really wanted to be honest about it, I'd say I was about 9, you know. I'd matured that much by my senior year. Because what happens if you find your instrument? You know, I thought it was the violin, then the trombone. I knew it wasn't the violin when I wound up in a little orchestra of 5-year-olds. And this guy I'd never seen in the basement of some big brick building gave us our downbeat, and we made a sound that I could still hear now. Put wrinkles in my pancreas. And I thought, we're really bad. And then I thought, maybe I'm part of that. So I wound up on the trombone, and I really thought that would be it. But then the guitar came along. And there was no doubt. I'd been sick a long time. It got me out of bed. But what happens is, if you find the one you want, that's all you want. You don't want anything else. And so you lock yourself away in some container, if you even have one. You know, some people just have to go out and sit in a cave and maybe try to find the instrument. You know, whether, if they're that poor, you know, that you have to live in. Never mind. This is you see the issue here. I mean, for me at any rate, I'm trying to get to the end of this sentence, knowing that I shouldn't have started it in the first place. I mean, you can't make up stuff, you know. If your sentence is crapped out on you, it doesn't matter what you come up with before the period. There's such terrible errors you can make opening. I called the wife, the widow of Stanley Watson once, and this was years after he died. I said, how did Stanley die? And she said, he was in walking along a road in Mount Juliet, Tennessee, and he was hit from behind by a poultry truck. And I cracked up. You know? She didn't see the humor in it. I think Stanley would, but he's not here to. What I'm getting at is that you lock yourself away with the instrument that you're supposed to be playing. As a result, all your development stops. You don't know how to socialize. You don't make any more friends if you ever had any in the beginning. You know, as a recovering trombone player or a recovering violin player, people avoid you. Found it somehow in a store in Falls Church. I was there one day when I came home in this car. And my dad decided I needed to, actually I decided I needed a car. My dad was hoping I wouldn't decide that. But my dad is the guy that supports all those gypsy roofers. You know? That was his, if somebody knocked on his door and said, I'll fix your roof for $300, he'd say, great, I've been looking for you. Well, can we have the money now? He said, sure. Larry, you can hear that voice. Larry, what happened to the roof? So he found a car that you could get for $100. And we drove, like I said, in Virginia, and we drove 8,000 miles, it seemed like, in his car to get my car. And we pulled up to a meth lab in North Carolina. And this guy walked out. First, there are these two really doubtful dogs, they were nasty, and we didn't get out of the car. And this guy got out of the house, and we wanted him to go back in the house. I did. But to my dad, he just looked like the right kind of that was right for him. This guy will take 50 bucks. Some spasm, you know, somewhere spavined, boil-ridden, just toothless, wrinkled up, 20-year-old. Spasmed up to the car, and here you are. And it was a Plymouth. And the only thing that, you know, the only thing you could know for sure about it was that it had oxidized. The whole car had oxidized. And it was a kind of, you know, if you built a hospital, filled it with TB patients, ran it for 60 years, abandoned it when they all got penicillin or whatever it is that worked finally, and then left it out in the rain for 50 years. This was my car. And it had a hole in the floorboard. Right here, about that big, you know, between the clutch and the brake. And I followed my dad. I said, "What's the hole for?" But I didn't care that the guy with no teeth didn't answer that question. I didn't want to, you know, I regretted asking it because I didn't want to involve him in a conversation. And I was driving home and I could see the road going by and through the hole. What the hell? I'm going to get a towel or something. And the next day I was driving it to school and I found out what the hole was for. It was so you could tell when the engine is on fire. I'm not lying about that. Your impulse at that point is to stop the car, get out of the car, and you do. And you know, you wait, and the flames just stop. This shouldn't have been that hard to fix. But I'm on my, what, fourth or fifth digression now. I don't know where to go anymore. I think a ballad is in order. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, good, it works. This one wasn't working during the sound check. This is a song that I wrote,
A car gives up.
No device takes much time, a crooked word, a lie. Now and then, the end's in sight. But every day, there's one more night. And far above, a sleeping town, dreams break up and the clouds come down. And far above, a sleeping town, dreams break up and clouds come down.
Feelings when I got close.
Nashville because I wanted to play some slide, and I just assumed that you went to a tuning to pull that off, but you don't have to do that. Derek Trucks has made that perfectly clear. Mountain States, and they were in their hometown for once, so somewhere in West Virginia. They were very kind of gypsy broadcasting out there. And you know, each broadcast has about four or five acts on it. And in their home space, they have this big auditorium, and the dressing rooms are flue stores down. And that's where I first heard Derek Trucks. It was two floors down. And I ran up to hear it better. I forget, it'll be apparent that I sitting on the railing, and there's a cowgirl, and they're all wrinkle-free, you know. And this this, you know, this Bronco, you know that look they have, Bronco, with another kid on it, wrinkle free. And I'd just stare at that thing. I could stare at that for 2 hours. My folks were concerned. They really were. They started keeping an eye out for anything that might space me out, because they knew. I mean, they really, it bothered them a great deal. They weren't into spacing out. They were into Vaughn Monroe. I don't know if anybody's ever heard that guy. Oh, God. He had a quality to him, but thank you. Get home. So long. And I'd listen to Vaughn, and I'd stare at the thing. I just did. I just walk off the dock somewhere. I actually did that. I did walk off the dock once, and I remember this. It's my earliest memory, I think, except possibly my mother's face. It was about this big, and it's right here, and it's singing. She's singing to me. I might have been younger than 2 and a half, because her head was never really that big. And she was kind of a petite woman altogether, so. And flexible her entire life. At 89, she could be a pretzel at a moment's notice. She loved to freak people out. I could do that at one time. I can do it with one leg, and I have to use my hands now. But when I was in junior high and high school, I could put both my legs behind my neck without using my hands, and then run around on my hands. There are certain things, skills, you know, that you learn to hide from your fellow human being. The coach in the, I don't know, it was basketball, whatever it was, in Muskogee, he said, Kotke, get out there and do that thing. And then, flip, and I'd scoot. I could really run, too. I mean, I could move. Here's a guy with his head up his own ass running around. Folks should see this, you know, some kid with his legs behind his neck looking at a hanky. Poor people. Larry, what have we done? Oh, man. I didn't make that. That's I walked off the dock. I remember this. I remember looking at the lake thinking, oh, well, why don't I go in there? And I just stepped off the dock. Now, I thought for decades, here's my shirt again. I thought for decades that I had to have dreamed this or just made it up, because as I fell into the water, I wasn't bothered or anything. I mean, I planned on this, and now I'm, you know, doing it. And I'm at 2 and a half, you know, you're bottom heavy, so I kind of dropped. It's Buddha's birthday today, and I had that kind of posture. I just dropped down. Probably, it wasn't very deep, but it was deep enough for a 2 and a half-year-old. And I hit the bottom, and this bubble, this is where it gets real dreamy, this bubble just went boop, up over and around my head, and I could look out of the bubble, and I saw three really nasty-looking, scraggly, dying weeds right over here. And I thought, I wonder, and I did. I thought, I think I can breathe in this. And I did. I took a breath in the bubble. See what I mean? It just sounds dumb. So, yeah, I mean, and I was... Here's my mom again, and we're up. This was at a cabin that my grandfather had built, kind of. Only it didn't work out right, and it bugged him to the day he died. You know, the windows were off, and it had a look to it. meth lab sort of look. And we're in there, they're going to sell it. My folks are going to sell a place. And I said, hey, I have this memory of jumping in the lake when I was little. She said, yeah. I was there. I said, well, what happened? Because all I remember is this bubble falling, and what followed that, I have no idea. She said, it's funny you'd ask, because your Aunt Ruby was here yesterday. And she said, what did Leo mean when I pulled him out of the lake? So Ruby spoiled my fun down there. So they were doing something on the dock, and I had something better to do. I'm submerged. Ruby jumped in and pulled me up and asked my mom what I meant when I said, I blowed up. I'm a submersible. I'm an amphibian. How cool am I?
Thank you.
That was written by Dwayne Allman, who played slide in Standard Time. Another one of these guys. And that song came to him in a dream. It was my dream. Sing Out. I think he had a regular column in an old magazine called Sing Out that was pretty fascinating and sometimes silly, and it was just perfect. And in this thing that he did, he was addressing those people who didn't have enough money to get a banjo or a guitar, and he was telling you how you could still play, and what he would. And so he gave you instructions, and there's a diagram or two in there on how to build a wall, and he called it a wall zither. And you first get some baling wire, why not go out and buy a cerebellum somewhere, you know. Where are you going to get? I mean, you're broke, first of all, but on top of that, you're going to go buy baling wire somewhere. You're going to find some, you know. You live in Minneapolis and downtown and buy a dumpster, and you're going to go get some. Let me borrow some baling wire. And then you get two spools. And these aren't, I don't know what he told you about these spools. Maybe it's just for thread. Now that's a possibility. You're making your own clothes, but you probably don't use thread. You probably use, you know, sheep mesentery. proud of myself with that. Do you know? Remind me, I gotta get back to that. But there was this thing during the German, the peak of popularity and also a composition for Baroque lute, German Baroque lute, that everybody had to have Italian lute strings. The German lute strings, and they're all made out of sheep mesentery, just didn't sound as good. Well, any guitar player in here knows all about this kind of thing. And or if anybody bought a record in 1970, you always thought that the British pressing was better and all that. And so I always assumed these people didn't know what they were talking about. It was all, you know, just nuts and krautrock and all that. And of course, I never had any way to compare myself. But I just found out that about the time the German Baroque was destroyed by Italian stuff, I don't know what to call it, but they had these long melody lines. And the German Baroque, it was all internal, you know, like Bach and who else could you see here that would put you through this? I'm just having a better time than you are. Really. Anyhow, about the time this happened, well, then things are, you know, everybody's sort of turning toward Italy now, and the great composer Leopold Sylvius Weiss trying to be sort of Italian. This was a guy who was he had a great job as the conductor for the something like the King of Poland. I forget what it. Some one of these city-state kind of deals, and the bassoon player in his orchestra attacked him one day and tried to bite his thumb off. Musicians, you know, they cannot be held back. You can't restrain them. But he got into the Italian, and somewhere in there, somebody found out why the Italian lute string sounded better. And it was, and the Italians had managed to keep this under their hat. It's because they didn't use sheep mesentery. Well, technically yes, but they used lambs. Sorry. They had a different way of, you know, things were different then. There's a great guy if you're into this kind of stuff. Named John Aubrey, he was mid sort of 1600s in England, lived in London, and he was destitute. You'd have a knock on your door, somebody would answer, oh God, it's him, and he'd walk in and he'd live with you for, you know, I don't know how long. But he was convinced that there were people who were gonna be entirely forgotten by history unless he wrote down their lives. So there's this collection of his writings called Brief Lives. And he gives you this book is, I mean, if you're having trouble, read some of this book. You'll feel better right away. It is the most astounding thing. And you know, like Walter Raleigh, he decides that guy should be memorialized. But most of these people, frankly, have been obliterated by history, and he didn't help. What he would do is he'd say, the Earl of Sandwich, or it could have been of, you know, Leicester, was born in 1590, maybe it was 1600, in March or September. He was either a tanner but he was known for, and he'd just go on with this. I mean, whoever he's thinking of, we never hear about him while he's writing this biography. And then at the end of almost all of them, he gives you a little homily or a motto or some kind of saying, and they're always wrong. I mean, they don't fit at all. And one of my favorites in this book was a woman who was a widow, a wealthy widow, that he thought should be preserved, you know, verbally at least, for history, And he tells you she might have been born and her name could have been such and such, and she's something or other, and she had a gardener. And the gardener, who had had the pox and his nose had collapsed, wore two corks in his nose to keep his nostrils open with goose quills shoved through the corks so he could breathe. This is one of the things he got right, you know? He didn't invent this. And so this wealthy widow marries the gardener with the corks in his nose and the goose quills and the collapsed face from the pox, from, you know, syphilis. And, you know, more attractive names for it than, like, the pox. She marries the guy. And, of course, she gets the pox, but she dies. And the gardener is left. He gets all the money. And the motto, or the, what he appends to this, and he's thinking of her, is a penny saved is a penny earned. He's like that, John Aubrey. And every now and then in this book, he'll mention some personal thing, and it's almost always a sore that he has on top of his head. And through the years, well, every now and then you hear about his sore and what it's now, what it's doing, and maybe it's better and maybe not. Where the hell was I? I think that was going somewhere. It's too late. You've already bought your tickets. I'm going to get there. You've been stealing the menudo from the back of pizza jars. That was the beginning of the start. You've been taking a tequila up until the after hour, but don't you take it too hard. And it's been 5 long years since you robbed the train at Chico. Now you're in the back of a truck, but that's what's from robbing the last train to Chico. So goodbye, Enrico, good luck. Nixon by that plane in San Perdue. Tell him he relied on blush too much. And did he smile and say he trusts you wearing running shoes? Was his pardon for your felonies a crutch? It's been 5 long years since you robbed the train to Chico. Now you're in the back of a truck, but that's what's from robbing the last train to Chico. So goodbye, and Enrico, good luck. Thank you. It's been 5 long years since you robbed the train to Chico. Now you are in the back of a truck. But that's what's from robbing the last train to Chico. So goodbye and a Nico, good luck. So goodbye. This is a song that I quit doing because I got a lot of requests for it, and I played it a lot, and, you know, and you just need a vacation, but it's probably up again. I'll play a couple more, and this is going to be one of them. Something eating at me though. There's something that I wanted to do that I'm not doing. Ever had that feeling? They said that Louise was not half bad. It was written on the wall and window shade. And though she'd act a little girl, but a deceiver, don't believe her. That's a trade. Sometimes a bottle of perfume, flowers, and maybe some lace. Too bad it ended so ugly. Dead already. All the way done. I know what to do. I know what to do. Thank you. this is a, you don't usually finish the night with this kind of thing, but I'm pooped. Just play it. Besides, when you forget a whole tune like I just did, what's something you might remember? Joe and I figured, Joe figured it out, I could only kind of guess, but I've played here at the Opera House now 32 times. You know, you live alone, you play alone, you travel alone, and this is how you get continuity. You can play new places all the time, but if you do that, you're not going to be working very long, because you just wear it all out, and nobody wants you back, is what it means. So places like this just are the continuity. Tell you what Ronnie Scott said one night in a place he saw a lot. He was a saxophone player because it was called Ronnie Scott's. And he went on stage there one. Oh, it's my slide. Went on. I mean, I'm used to a different kind of fabric experience. I've grown something. I went on stage there one night with his saxophone, and he said, I should have stayed in bed. There were more people there. No continuity around Scott. This might be a little ungainly, but it's called Crow River Waltz. I wrote this long time. After a disastrous trip down the Crow River in a canoe. That isn't as easy as it looks.